Good evening, all of you. Welcome to another session on webinar. We've done almost 18 sessions so far. a small brief again about Kottayam Nature Society and Alappi Naturalistic Society, the two NGOs which does a lot of ground level conservation work in part of Kerala. And today we are lucky to get one of the finest biologists in India. When I said finest biologist, Hari actually wrote to me, and why did you write like that? We heard a lot of people from us. He's the one who actually more keen on doing ecology work. We have a lot of biologists, they do taxonomical study and all, but Hari is the one who actually keen to study ecological work also. So he done almost 6 years study throughout a lot of islands in Andamans and Nicobar area. He's one of the very good with identifying reptiles and amphibians. So let's hear from him, his experience, and we hope we can learn a lot from him. Over to you, Hari.
Yeah, thanks, David. Good evening, everyone. So today's talk, like David mentioned, it will be based on the work I did in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands between 2008 and 2014. So it'll be a general introduction to reptiles and amphibians of Andaman and Nicobar Islands. So I've divided the talk into somewhat like two parts. The first part will be just about reptiles and amphibians. The second part, I'll try to introduce you to some of the conservation issues specific to reptiles and amphibians. There are many other problems there, but we'll stick to problems involving reptiles and amphibians. So you all know where Andaman Nicobar Islands are. When we view the islands from mainland India, we tend to think of them as one unit. We just say Andaman Nicobar Islands. But in the Bay of Bengal, this is a wide stretch of islands. And if you zoom in, you can clearly see that there are two major groups of islands. The one group to the north is called the Andamans, and the groups to the south are called the Nicobar Islands. So these are separated by a really deep sea channel. It's called the 10-degree channel because it's situated at the 10-degree latitude. So this essentially acts as a biogeographic barrier between Andamans and the Nicobar Islands. And within the Nicobar Islands, there are further subdivisions also, but we'll not get into those details right now. So as you can see from the position of the islands themselves, that they are much closer to Southeast Asia than they are to mainland India. Like from the Nicobars, Sumatra is just a couple of hundred kilometers away. So because of this proximity with Southeast Asia, you see that the fauna and flora of these islands are also similar to Southeast Asia, more similar to Southeast Asia than they are to, let's say, the Western Ghats or other parts of India. And these are very young islands also. So that is another thing that you have to consider when you're studying in places like this, because you can't expect to find the same level of diversity that you will see in place like the Western Ghats or the Eastern Himalayas. You will see diversity, but not the same number of different species. But there are certain other phenomena that are super interesting about such islands, small islands. So there are couple of different ways to get to the islands. You can travel usually from Chennai or Kolkata. I think there are also some travel options from places like Visakhapatnam and all. So if you take a ship from any of these places, might take you 2 to 3 days to get to these islands. If you take a flight, it'll be just about 2 hours. So being a researcher with Wildlife Institute, for the at least in the initial part of this study, I had to take ships, which means that you had to travel 2-3 days at a time to just to get to the islands. But if you get a chance, it's a good experience and you should take it. So mostly when you think of islands, okay, there are about 500 different islands within this Andaman Nicobars, right? And most of them are small islands. Okay, there are very few large islands. Like this, this is Grub Island, a very small island. You can just walk from one end of this island to the other in 10 minutes maybe. So most islands are small formations like this. But they still support an incredible diversity of fauna and flora. And travel within the islands, once you get to these islands, is basically mostly dependent on small boats. Among the major islands, let's say South Andaman, Port Blair, and the tourist destinations like Havelock, you will have ferry services. But when you want to survey, let's like snakes and lizards and all, you have to travel to remote locations in the island. And your only choice is to hire these small boats, fishing boats. And so this is also dependent on weather conditions. At any time, you know, the weather can turn bad, you know, clouds can come in, the sea can get rough. So your entire work in these islands is dependent on sea conditions. So what I have done for the introduction to the fauna of these islands is to just look at some of the habitats that you will find and what are the some of the interesting species that you will find in these areas. And most people, when they think of islands, they think of blue water and sandy beaches, right? White sandy beaches. So of course, the islands are well known for it. Its tourism is basically dependent on this particular habitat. And during the day, the beaches look beautiful like this. But if you go there at night in many of these places, one of the common species that you will encounter is this yellow-lipped sea crate. Now, sea crates are very interesting snakes. They are not true sea snakes, even though they have a paddle-shaped tail. They still have belly scales like other snakes. So they spend a lot of time on land. Now, what we have noticed about sea crates in the Andamans is that in islands where people live, they come up on land during the night. But if you go to offshore small islands where there are no people, you can see that they come up even during daytime. They spend a lot of time on land. They mate on land. They lay eggs on land. They bask for a long time. Basically, they just go back into the coral reefs for feeding. And these are venomous snakes, but there are no records of anybody getting bitten by them. So this is one of the more common species. There is one more species that you occasionally get. It's called the blue-lipped sea crate. And that's probably the only species that you'll commonly see on the beaches. But if you move further in, you'll get other ecosystems like mangroves. Now, mangroves are a very, very interesting sort of ecosystem, you know, half water, half land, or half the time underwater, half the time above water, right? In this, Andaman has one of the most extensive mangrove systems after the Sundarbans in India. Very extensive mangrove system throughout the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. And there you get this really interesting species of frog. Now, if you know anything about frogs, you know that they have hygroscopic skin. You know, they absorb water through the skin, and most of them are not tolerant to salt water, right? However, this particular species of frog is somewhat more tolerant of saltwater conditions. This is called a mangrove frog. And this particular individual I photographed, this is a male that was calling from a water-filled puddle in a mangrove. So very, very interesting species. Because of this particular character, I think it's quite widely distributed. And there could be multiple species within that. We are not sure of the taxonomy of this. That's another study waiting to be done. And they also, sometimes they're called crab-eating frogs because they eat a lot of crustaceans, whatever food they can find in these mangrove areas. Now, another species that you will find, especially in creeks that are where water is flowing from the sea into the mangroves, is this snake called a file snake. Now, they're called file snake because it's the texture of the skin. You know, it's like a file that you use for grinding things, right? So it's quite an aquatic snake. In fact, it doesn't have belly scales for moving on land. So if you put it on land, it just cannot move. And it also looks like the skin is too large for its body. It's just completely wrinkly. But if in underwater, if you see the snake, it's extremely graceful. So this is another species that you occasionally encounter in the mangroves. It's not a very common species there. But this is an extremely common species. So this is called the dog-faced water snake. You can see this species throughout the coastland, wherever there are mangroves in India. I think this species is found all the way up to Mumbai, I think. Anytime you go into the mangroves, especially after sunset, you'll see these snakes poking their head and neck out of holes in the ground in the mud, waiting for fish to swim by and then to catch them. In this case, this one is eating a mud skipper. Mud skippers are also very interesting animals there. So those, other than that, this is the Andaman water monitor. Now this is a juvenile. Why we call it Andaman water monitor? Because this particular subspecies is only found in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Okay. Now they get quite big. They can grow to more than 2 meters long. This particular individual is just a juvenile that had entered our base station kitchen there. So I managed to catch it and take one photo like this. So it's a completely set up photograph. You will not see them like this in the mangroves. And other than mangroves, a coastal ecosystem includes these inland freshwater bodies, basically. It's like small pools of freshwater or wetlands, you can call them. Some really interesting species are found here, such as the red deer frog. This is only found in the Nicobar Islands. The species is also supposed to be found in islands of Southeast Asia as well. But this is a species that you'll never see inside the forest. And you also see snakes such as Boye's mud snake. Again, this is also from the Nicobar Islands. Not a very common species of snake. I think it is only reported from Great Nicobar. That's the only place I have seen it. However, when you're looking for these animals, you also have to be careful of saltwater crocodiles, because any of these water bodies in the Andamans, whether it's be it beaches or mangroves or freshwater bodies and streams in the forest, you have to be aware of the potential presence of saltwater crocodile. You know that this is the largest species of crocodile in the world, you know, and Andaman has quite a healthy population of these. So you can see them basking out in the sun sometimes like this. Now, you know, the greatest diversity of reptiles and amphibians is found within evergreen forests. Now, forests cover a large part of Andaman and Nicobar Islands. I think it still has more than 80% of forest cover. One of the endemic species from the Andamans is this Andaman brown bullfrog. Now, this used to be considered as a subspecies of another species that is found in Southeast Asia. But recent studies have indicated this is actually an endemic species. And what we suspect is that this will be true of a lot of species from the Andamans, that what we consider as a widespread species will turn out to be an endemic to those islands. This is quite an arboreal species that spends most of the summer time in the Andamans in tree holes, hiding in tree holes, and emerging only during the rains. And when it emerges for breeding, it's a very, very noisy frog. So if you're camping next to a pond or something where these guys are breeding, you just cannot sleep. They're extremely noisy. Another endemic frog, this time from the Nicobar Islands, is this tree frog, the Nicobar tree frog. Now, this is the only known tree frog from the Nicobar Islands, Andaman Nicobar Islands. Why there are no other species of tree frogs in the Andamans, we don't know. The species is only found in Great Nicobar and some adjacent islands in the southernmost group. This is called a Champin frog. So it is a fairly recently discovered frog. It's a very large species of frog. Why it's called Champin? It's actually named after a group of tribals from Great Nicobar Islands called Champins. They are a sort of a hunter-gatherer tribe. So when it was discovered, it was within their territory. So it was named as Champin frog. Now, they belong to a group of frogs that are generally called the fanged frogs. The fanged frogs, or the large frogs of the genus Limnonectes. They are found in mostly in Southeast Asia. The males of these Fang frog, they have canine-like projections on the lower jaw. These are not actual teeth. These are extensions of the jawbone, basically, that they seemingly used for fighting among males. That seems to be the reason for these projections. So in this species also, the large individuals, males, you can see these fang-like projections. And this is also found only in southern Nicobar Islands. Now, this lizard, this is my favorite lizard from the Andaman Islands. It's found almost throughout the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. It's called the Bay Island Forest Lizard. Its genus, Coryphophyllax, is endemic to the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. And it is super abundant everywhere. If you go to some places in undisturbed forest, the numbers can be so high that it's difficult to walk with, or you know, you should, the lizards will be running here and there. You have to be careful not to step on them. They can be that abundant. So this is a semi-arboreal kind of lizard, mostly sitting on the roots or, you know, buttress roots of trees and small saplings, found throughout the Andaman Nicobars. This is also a very common species in the Andamans called the emerald day gecko. So for this species, you don't have to go into forest. You can be in a farmland or a plantation. There are lots of plantations, especially in the Andamans. You can see them basking on banana leaves or coconut trees and things like that. What makes this emerald day gecko so unique is that this genus, that is Felsuma, all other species of this genus are found in Madagascar and Seychelles Islands and those regions, you know, in the Indian Ocean. And this one species somehow managed to cross all that ocean space and come to the Andaman Islands and spread in the Andaman. It's not found in the Nicobar Islands. It's only in the Andaman Islands. So for scientists, this is a very, very interesting species. And it's also a very beautiful species. The males of this species is even more beautiful. The breeding males can have the, apart from that green, they can have bright blue and orange colors on the body also. It's an extremely beautiful species that you can find anywhere in the Andamans. Similarly, this species of lizard from Nicobar Islands. These are called green crested lizards of the genus Broncosela. Now, Broncosela is a genus that is mostly found in Southeast Asia. But the Nicobar Islands have three species. You will not see them in the Andaman Islands. Again, this is a species that can live in the forest, open areas, any kind of places. As long as there is no deforestation, they seem to thrive. And the breeding males tend to develop all these bright colors like this. And each species has a different color pattern that they develop also. And they're also called long-tailed agama sometimes because the tail is extremely long. Like tail can be like three times the length of the body. Now, this is, it looks like a snake, but it's not. It's a limbless lizard. It has no legs. It's called a Nicobar worm lizard. So interestingly, if you look at the males of this species, you can see small flaps of skin where the legs used to be, but they are completely dysfunctional. In a way, they remind me of shield-tailed snakes from Western Ghats. You know, the head is also shaped like that, like a spade. The eyes are under scales so that they can burrow deeply into soil. So this is only found in the Nicobar Islands. And for my first 1 year, I did not see a single individual of this. But it turned out that it was a very common species. You had to be, you know, searching on the forest floor, removing the leaf litter and starting to dig. And then it became a very common species in the Nicobar Islands. Very, very unique species. In fact, this family is only reported from the Nicobar Islands in India. The rest of the members of this particular family are found in Southeast Asia only. Now, these are also endemic to the Andaman Islands. These are called green bronze spats, Dendrilophus andamanensis. This is found throughout the Andaman Islands, but not in the Nicobar Island. However, this species Dendrolophis homeyunai. This is endemic to the Nicobar Islands. So you will not see this one in the Andaman Islands. Now, these are similar in habit to most of the other bronzeback tree snake that you find throughout India. They are diurnal snakes. They mostly eat frogs and lizards. And you can see them very commonly in most places. Another endemic snake from the Andaman Islands is the Andaman cat snake. Now, a very beautiful species. The juveniles are this orange-red color. But as they grow, the adults tend to lose this color and they become like pale brown or olive brown color. This species is just endemic to the Andaman group of islands, not found in the Nicobar. And it's a nocturnal species. It comes out only at night. During the daytime, sometimes you see it curled up into a little ball in leaf litter or among some tree hole or something like that. Now, this is another really interesting snake from Great Nicobar Island. Nicobar Islands is the only place within India that we know of this snake. This is usually how you see it if you're searching for it. Very difficult to see on the forest floor. But to see its actual colors and shine, you have to put it in a plain background because its body is so shiny. It's called a sunbeam snake, Cynopeltis unicolor, a very unique family of snakes. I think there are only about two species within this family, and one of those species is found in the Nicobars. The body is extremely shiny, very difficult to take a photograph of because the flash tends to reflect really badly. This is also a burrowing snake that is restricted to the Nicobars. Another snake from the Nicobar Islands is this triangle spotted keelback. It's called the triangle spotted because of these markings on the side of the body. Now, juveniles have this really beautiful orange or reddish patterns on the side of the body. Within the Andaman Nicobars, they are also restricted to the southern group of islands in the Nicobars. Now, coming to the venomous snakes. So far, what most of the species that we covered other than the sea crate were all non-venomous snakes. There are a few species of venomous snakes within the Andamans, and we start with the first one, which is the endemic species, that is Andaman crate. Now, it's only found within the Andaman Islands. There are no crates in the Nicobar Islands. And mostly this species, I've seen it feeding on frogs and lizards for the most part. In this case, it's actually eating what is called an Andaman litter skink, another endemic species. So we don't know how toxic the venom of this species is, as I don't think there's been any deaths from its bite. But considering most crates are highly toxic, I would imagine that it also has a very potent neurotoxin. And there are two kinds of cobras also within the Andamans. The first one is the endemic species Andaman cobra. In my experience, it's not a common snake there. It's quite a forest-dwelling species. I found it in forests and mangroves also. We also have a type of king cobra, and many individuals have this beautiful, like orange-brown color, which is stark contrast to what you find in, let's say, mainland India, the Western Ghats, the black ones from the Western Ghats, or the grayish ones from other places. This very interesting color pattern, and they can go quite large. But it's quite an uncommon species. I've only seen it a couple of times in the Andamans. Now, all these cobras and crates, the snakes of the family Elapidae, the short front fang snake, they're only found in the Andaman Islands. If you cross over to the Nicobar Islands, there are no cobras, no crates. There are only pit vipers. Now, coming to pit vipers, this pit viper is the most common one in the Andaman Islands, the Anderson's pit viper. No matter where you go in the Andamans, mostly this species is present. It's a very common species. If it's raining, you'll probably see this species crossing the road. And it's a very variable species also. It can come in different colors. I've seen everything ranging from black to almost pale yellow ones. But when you go to the Nicobars, there are multiple species of pit vipers, depending on where you are. For example, this is a Carnicobar pit viper. It's a very small species of pit viper. highly variable in colors, and it's only found in one island, that is Car Nicobar. It's the northernmost island in the Nicobars. So the area, total area of that island is about 120 square kilometers, approximately. So the whole range of this species is less than that. Similarly, this species, the central Nicobar pit viper, Trimeriserus mutabilis, very similar to the Car Nicobar pit viper, this species is found in about 7 or 8 small islands. So if you add up the area of all the small islands, I think the distribution of the snake will be less than 100 or 200 square kilometers or something like that. So very, very narrow distribution. These are narrow endemics. Same central Nicobar Islands, there is a second of the second species of pit viper. That's called the Cantor's pit viper. This is also endemic to the central Nicobar Islands. Now this can get quite large. I think they can grow up to about 5 feet almost. And males or females are completely different. I think females grow much, much larger than males. And this particular individual was actually, I rescued it from a house in Kamota, one of the islands in central Nicobars, after it had eaten a chicken, somebody's chicken. It had eaten somebody's chicken and then taken up residence in a small tree there. So you can see the belly is extremely distended because the bird is still inside. It's a huge animal. But if you look at some other individual, same species, but they can be small, you know, bright green. Now I've seen other color forms also, the ones with the spots on the body, ones with the stripes on the body. So an extremely variable endemic species only found in those 7 or 8 islands in central Nicobar Islands. Now another thing is that this is also probably a species that causes a few bites. We have heard of some incidences where the bite of the species has caused the human mortality, but these are still require verification. I think there are 1 or 2 cases of confirmed deaths from the bite of this species. So this is a species of medical concern. There is no anti-venom for the bite of any of these snakes. Now the next habitat that we should consider is that the mountain tops. So Andamans don't have huge mountains, but if you look at the geography of the islands, you see that these are in fact a long mountain chain, you know, starting from the Arakan Yomas in the Burma or going all the way down to Mentawai Islands in Sumatra. It's like the exposed peaks of mountains that pop up as islands. And within that you have these small peaks. This is the highest peak in the Andaman. It's called the Saddle Peak, about 750 meters or something like that. So that doesn't sound like much of an elevation, right? Especially when you're thinking of Western Ghats or Himalayas or something. But within this small range of elevation, you get a really, really interesting change in vegetation and fauna and weather conditions, etc. For example, during a bright sunny day, Saddle Peak looks like this. Now, the highest point in the Nicobars is the Mount Tholiar, which is covered in clouds here. This is an extremely rainy, cloudy day. So I'd like to briefly mention that there is an interesting difference between Andamans and Nicobars, especially when you travel south. In the Andamans, you have a clear dry and wet season, like a clear monsoon season, and there is a dry season. As you travel south, especially in Great Nicobar, you realize that there is no clear-cut dry season. It seems to rain almost every month of the year. I've been there in that Great Nicobar Island in January, February, March, June, October, November, anytime I've been to that island, there's been rain. So these are like true evergreen rainforest, probably the most unspoiled, pristine rainforest that you can find in India is found in Great Nicobar Island. So if you climb up these peaks, especially during the rains, they sort of remind you of Shola Forest. For those of you who are familiar with the Shola Forest of Western Ghats, they have a similar feeling, you know, the mist-covered, stunted vegetation covering these peaks. And these areas also host some really interesting species, such as this Darwin's frog. It's a very unique species. It lays eggs in tree holes, water-filled tree holes. The eggs basically just develop. The tadpoles almost don't need to feed at all. They just develop quickly and become frogs. So we think that this might be a strategy they evolved so that they don't have to depend on freshwater bodies. You know, freshwater bodies are not very common in the islands, right? So this might be an evolutionary strategy that they have developed over time. So this is a species endemic to the Andaman Islands, described from Mount Harriet National Park. And we have found this species in a few other islands also. It's also considered a critically endangered frog. Similarly, we found this really, really interesting tiny little toad. So it's not a frog, it's more related to your, you know, common toads, etc., or the tree toads of the Western Ghats or other places. But this is really small, like the size of your fingernail or thumbnail, basically. And it sounds like a cricket, but it's an arboreal toad. So unique genus, the genus itself is endemic to the Andaman Islands. And that last name, Periyet, is basically means small frog in one of the Andamanese languages. So this also has a very similar breeding strategy as the Darwin frog, that it also lays its eggs in water-filled tree holes and the tadpoles develop there. The species is also endemic to the Andaman Islands. And they are not found in the Nicobars. Similarly, another endemic to the Andamans is this short-tailed forest lizard. Remember I said that Coryphophyllax, the genus, is endemic to the Andaman. So this is the second species of Coryphophyllax, where this one is only found in the Andamans. The previous species was also found in the Nicobar Islands. Now, some individuals of this, they look so similar to some lizards from southern India, such as the kangaroo lizard, Autocryptus species. The parallel evolution is just amazing. You also get this really interesting agamid lizard, the Andaman canopy dragon. I call it canopy dragon because it lives most of its life high up in the canopy of trees. And the only times I've come across this is when males tend to fight each other and they fall off the branches. So the bright yellow color of the inside of the mouth and the tongue, that they develop, the males develop during the breeding season. And so this is one of the individuals I found, like these two individuals were fighting and they fell down. So we found them like this. So this is also a missing species for a long time, but we found them after like 100 years or so. It's actually quite a common species in the Andaman. It's just that to see it, you know, you have to be using a binocular to look up in the trees or climb the trees itself. Now, the last major kind of habitat that I want to talk about is this limestone caves. Many places in the islands have this extensive limestone cave system, and they're really interesting little habitats. Particularly for those of you who are interested in birds, these caves provide a lot of nesting habitat for swiftlets, both the glossy swiftlet and the edible nest swiftlets. And there are places in the Andamans where they have created protection areas for edible nest swiftlets. Now, many of these caves are situated facing the sea in many places so that you cannot access them unless you take a boat and go out and come into the sea. And the other thing is, like you can see here, this is taken during the low tide. So if you are in the same place during high tide, that opening will be much, much smaller. The water level will be much higher. So this is excellent for many species because they get protection from all other kind of disturbances. So one of the common species that you find in such places is the bent-toed gecko. This is also very common in the forest. This species is endemic to the Andaman Islands. There is a different species that is found in the Nicobars. Then you also see this black-tailed rat snake. Now in Southeast Asia, this species is called a yellow-striped rat snake. But because they have a long yellow stripe that is running down the back. But in the Andamans, they don't have this stripe. So it's a very unique population in the Andamans. So we just call them black-tailed trinkets or black-tailed rat snake. It's a species found in the Andamans, not in the Nicobars. But I think the most beautiful of all these large snakes is this red-tailed rat snake. Now, it's a very, very large species, 2.5 meters almost in length. Quite a slow-moving species also. And the best place to find these snakes is inside caves where there are bats and swiftlets. They just sit on a ledge in a cave and just wait for a bat or a swiftlet to fly across, and they just launch at them. So there was an interesting report where a bat researcher had basically found one catching three swiftlets at the same time, two in the body coil and one in the mouth. So really, really interesting, beautiful snake. Now we come to the second part of this talk, that is conservation issues, particularly regarding reptiles and amphibians in the Andamans. So straight away, I'm going to start with this saltwater crocodile. Over the years, there's been what is perceived as an increase in the number of attacks on people by saltwater crocodiles. Now, saltwater crocodiles are really large predators. So coexistence with saltwater crocodile is a tricky issue, right? Now, I don't know whether the number of attacks on people have increased over time, or it's that we are reporting them more and we are detecting them more recently. The problem here is that it starts with lack of information. Most of the studies on saltwater crocodiles in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands are from the 80s and early 90s. So there have been hardly any recent in-depth study of saltwater crocodile numbers in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. The population seems to be really healthy. Wherever you go, you tend to see signs of saltwater crocodiles. Now, without this kind of data, it's really difficult to come up with the solutions. Currently, even conservationists are unsure how to exactly manage this issue. There is a group of people who think that maybe we should manage them actively. Like if there are too many crocodiles in some place, we should catch them, we should cull them, etc. There's also people who believe that we should learn to coexist with this large predator, you know, change our behavior accordingly so that these issues can be controlled. But right now, it's a completely open problem, and let's hope that somebody will come up with some better solutions for this. But I will not talk much about it right now because it was not my focus. It's just something that I picked up during the time I was there. So another interesting thing is the tsunami of December 2004, which we are all aware of, and its aftermath. Now, remember that the epicenter of that Aceh earthquake was pretty close to Andaman and Nicobar Islands in particular. So Nicobar Islands took the brunt of the force of the tsunami, especially in Great Nicobar and Southern Nicobar Islands. The land just disappeared under the sea, as you can see from this picture. You know, the islands just basically depressed by a couple of meters, I think. And it's still like that. The sea has taken a lot of land there. Now, what sort of problems this created for the local fauna and flora? Let's come back to this red-eared frog that I mentioned earlier. I said that the species is found in coastal wetlands, low elevation, small pools of water that you find close to the coast, right? In most of Nicobar Islands, these coastal wetlands have basically disappeared. They basically got taken by the sea. So that habitat has completely disappeared. Now, this frog was found throughout Nicobar Islands in surveys carried prior to the tsunami, 2004. In 2008, when I first did my survey in the Nicobars, I found this frog only in two islands, southernmost island in Great Nicobar, because it's a very large island, and the northernmost island, Car Nicobar Island, where some of the central areas of that island was not affected by the tsunami. Now, what happened to all the other island populations of this frog? Are they gone extinct? Think of it like this. It's considered as the least concerned species. This graph basically shows the allotment of species to different categories by IUCN, right? And this shows the percentage of species of Indian amphibians and reptiles. You can see that the red-eared frog is considered a least concerned species because it's also found in Southeast Asia. But currently, studies are showing that the island populations in different parts of Asia are completely different species. Now, none of those studies included the Nicobar species. It's quite likely that the Nicobar species is endemic to the Nicobar Islands. So is it still a least concerned species? And is it possible that that species has gone extinct from a lot of islands now? Now, there are additional problems there also, that human settlement patterns have changed and other things. But there is a fundamental problem in assigning species to these categories also. The other thing I want to point out is that you can also see the critically endangered Darwin's frog. When we did our study, one of my objectives was to look at the number, population sizes of these species and how widely they're distributed. It's actually quite widely distributed species and a rather common species also, if you're in the right place. So is that critically endangered? Maybe there are other issues with it. But I surely don't think that the red-eared frog should be in the least concerned category. And look at that other category, data deficient or not assessed, the highest category. 65% of our reptiles are not assessed or there is no data about it. So this is where we are supposed to make conservation decisions based on this information. Coming to a slightly different issue, this time, Andaman Islands. There is a road called the Andaman Trunk Road that was created post-independence, I think. It runs from South Andaman all the way to Northern Andaman, cutting through some of the most beautiful forests in the entire Andamans. It's called the Andaman Trunk Road, right? It's basically designed so that there is some connectivity between Central Andaman, Middle Andaman, and North Andaman, small townships, right? It passes through the Jarawa Tribal Reserve. Now, Jarawas are one of the Aboriginal tribes of the Andaman Islands. So this is a line of vehicles at the check post in Jirkatan, where it entry point into the Jarawa Tribal Reserve in the morning. Now, there is a court order currently saying that this road should be closed, but it still remains open. Now, the problems that this bring are many. Of course, we understand that people have a need for connectivity and transport, etc. But there is option of travel through the sea via ferry, etc. Now, this road that passes through this Jarawa Tribal Reserve, one of the most beautiful forests there, it opens up a lot of issues. From biodiversity point of view, it promotes basically the intrusion of invasive species. Many invasive species are forest edge species. So it basically creates a long edge through the forest where species can invade into deep into the forest, right? Another issue is that of human tourism, basically human safaris. This was a big issue a few years back, where people are coming just to see Jarawa tribals standing on the side of the road and creating all sorts of cultural problems with it. Now, a third issue I want to talk about is that of introduced species in the Andaman Islands. Now, this is a photo I found on the internet. I couldn't find whose photo it is, but it is from an island called Ross Island. Ross Island is basically a tourist destination. It's a small island close to Port Blair in South Andaman. Now you can see that there are peacocks there, there are deer there, spotted deer basically. Now, spotted deer was introduced into the Andaman Islands in the early part of 20th century by Britishers for hunting purpose basically. Not just spotted deer, they introduced other species of deer also. I think they introduced sambar and hog deer and barking deer also. So barking deer is still widespread. Spotted deer is still widespread. Hog deer, I think we will find in one or two places in the Andaman still, but they are not that abundant. But that's not the case with spotted deer. Spotted deer is found more, almost throughout the Andaman Islands, except probably only in among the larger islands. It's not found in Little Andaman Island, which is a very interesting comparison. So why I think this is a problem? This is a comparative image of a rainforest understory. So the left side image is from an island, like I said, Little Andaman Island, where there are no spotted deer. Both photos were taken in the month of January, so this is not seasonal difference. They're like relatively dry months. The second is an island from Mahatma Gandhi Marine National Park in South Andaman, where there are a lot of deer. So one of the things that spotted deer does is, it's generally an open forest species, right? It likes to browse on things, grass and small bush and things like that. But what happens when you introduce such a species to islands dominated by forests? They have to adapt, and the spotted deer has basically adapted to feeding on small saplings on the forest floor. So there are lots of interesting things that have happened with the deer themselves, such as smaller herd sizes and, you know, their habits, etc. So we basically came across this when we were looking for lizards on the forest floor. We were searching for lizards and we could not find lizards in many of these islands. And instead, we were finding deer pellets, deer droppings, basically. So this, we started thinking whether this is connected to, you know, the lack of lizards is connected to deer in some way. So because of this, we started looking into it and we realized that there is already studies, particularly by Professor Rauf Ali, late Professor Rauf Ali and his team, that clearly showed that, you know, the deer in many places in the Andamans is completely altering the forest understory structure, slowly changing the characteristics of the vegetation of the rainforest itself. So from our point of view, this was really interesting because it was also affecting reptiles and amphibians, where there were a lot of reptiles and where there were a lot of deer, at least deer signs, there were fewer reptiles present. So the comparison became really interesting when we looked at an island like Little Andaman, where there was no deer. And these lizards were super abundant. Like I said, you know, you can't walk without stepping on lizards in some places. So how can this happen? The primary way seemed to be that they are destroying the habitat, especially the understory of the forest. Now, this is a really hard thing for most people to get their head around, because we always think of spotted deer as like a protected species, right? It is a protected species in India. Now, this is an example that a protected species within this country can become a problem species elsewhere, right? And it's a tricky issue now because there are multiple roadblocks in addressing this. First one is legal. Second one is a moral issue. How do you address this now? What do you do with all the deer? How do you manage them? So we had a student who initially came there, Nitya Mohanty, who came there to study this particular issue for his master's dissertation, and then he went on to complete a PhD also on invasive species in the Andamans. So very, very interesting and very kind of very interesting issue problem in the Andaman Islands, especially with the invasive species. Now, deer are not the only things that are found in the forest. Many places you will see cattle in the forest, like cattle that have been abandoned and they just roam the forest and start breeding. Like this one, this is a small calf from Little Long Island. In some places in the Nicobars, we will find rogue bulls, you know, within the forest. Bulls are still okay, but in places You can also find buffaloes roaming the forest in some places. So sort of dangerous for people who are looking for frogs and lizards at night, if you're not careful. So there are a bunch of invasive species like this. And the most recent one, and one that we tracked fairly well, is that of the Indian bullfrog. Again, another protected species from mainland India, right? A bullfrog is found throughout India. It's a very large species of frog, and it can eat almost anything smaller than itself. So the biology of this species is really interesting. And we first reported this species in around 2013 from Middle Andaman. And since then, Nitya, the student I mentioned earlier, he went on to study this frog and its invasion for his PhD. And he's documented the spread of this species throughout the Andaman Islands, how fast this species has spread, and what is its effect on local endemic species of frogs and lizards. And some experiments show that they actually eat almost everything. 100% mortality of, you know, other species of tadpoles, for example, when bullfrog tadpoles are present in the same system. So another invasive species that is spreading fast, and we don't have any real solutions right now to deal with it. Yet another species not very well studied is the Oriental Garden Lizard. Now, we don't know whether it is actually the same species found in throughout India or another one that is found in Myanmar and those regions. Now, this was first recorded in early part of 20th century from Northern Andamans. Now, over time, it has spread towards the south, and after the tsunami for the first time in 2006, it was reported from Kar Nicobar Islands. So it has slowly extended its range from Northern Andamans all the way down to Northern Nicobars. Now, nobody knows the effect of these lizards, if they have any. Sometimes species don't have any harmful effects also. But in this case, we don't know what could be the effect of these invasions in Nicobar Islands. So this is just a compilation of some of the introduced species that are recorded from these islands. Some photos are not mine, I just collected them. You can see that, you know, almost everything, like even there are islands with elephants. Particularly Interview Island. There are herds of elephants in Interview Island. Those elephants were originally taken there for timber work, and then now they become wild and they're throughout that island. You can also see the African snail, which is another pest species in many places. You wouldn't think that a red-whiskered bulbul is an invasive species, but it is in Central Nicobar Islands. So many such species present in these islands. And I think with that, I will wrap up this talk and we can take questions if you have any. Thank you, guys.
David is there.
David, I don't know if he's there.
He has got some work. So you see the chat box, questions will be there. So I'm trying to answer that.
Hello, I'm here. Sorry.
Okay.
Hi, sir.
Okay, questions, right?
Yeah.
Should I just read them and then?
Yeah, that's better. If you can just go through the list and you can just answer all those questions, that would be better.
Okay. So Tushar Abhayankar asks, what are the endemic mammals found in Andaman and Nicobar Islands? So I'm not a mammal expert, but I think there is a subspecies of civet, that is a paguma larvata titlare, that is endemic to Andamans. And there are many bats and rodents. I believe there are many rodent species that are endemic to Andaman Nicobar Islands. Nicobar also has a Nicobar tree shrew, which is endemic to the southern Nicobars. Am I missing anything? Yes, there is also a subspecies of pig, the Andaman wild pig, which is much smaller than the regular wild pig that's endemic to the Andaman Islands. And that's all I can think of right now. Okay. Adesh Shivakar asks, the juvenile of Andaman tree snake, is it black? Adesh, I think you're asking about the green trinket snake, right? It's not black, it's usually bright green, bronze green almost. Dr. Jishnu says, crab-eating macaque in the Nicobars. Crab-eating macaque is present in the Nicobar Islands, southern Nicobars. I think the subspecies is also, that subspecies is probably endemic to the Nicobars. Sure. So, Satyan Mepayur asked, why the absence of higher animals like cat family? That's a really interesting biogeographic question, right? So, the absence of certain groups of animals. We don't know, actually. It could be that they never managed to reach these islands. You know, it has to also do with how species reach these islands. Remember that these were islands that basically came up from the sea. They were not connected to any of the land masses. So, species that can disperse in some way are more likely to reach these islands. And also, I believe that if you have larger species like leopards and, you know, they will need much more resources in terms of large animals, right? So these, in small islands, generally, this kind of resources for food resources for larger animals are scarce. And so even if some species of the cat family, like a leopard or tiger, reaches these islands, the chances of survival in small islands is probably very low. But in my opinion, I think it has more to do with the difficulty in reaching these islands. Satyan, I hope I've answered your question. What species of turtle was it in the last slide? I think Yashasini Narayan asked, what species of turtle was in the last slide? That was a common, flap shell turtle from India. So it was introduced in some places near Port Blair, and it's found in some small ponds in South Andaman. Lissomys punctata, that is the scientific name. So Debayan Gayan asked, what are the pointers to differentiate Andaman water lizard? I think you mean Andaman water monitor? That of mainland monitor species. So there are a series of subtle differences. I can send you the taxonomic paper sometime. There are subtle differences, but main thing is all you can also notice the color difference, especially in adults, that the Andaman lizards are water monitors are very black with the small yellow spots on it. They're not banded like the common water monitor lizard. Dr. Meera KM, have you covered all the islands of Andaman Nicobar? No, ma'am, I haven't. There are, like I said, nearly 500 islands in the Andaman Nicobars. So for my work, I traveled almost all the major islands from northern Andaman to the southernmost Nicobar Islands, and selectively sampling in islands in different places. So I've covered about 30 islands maximum, but from north to south. Krishnendu asks, what are those geckos in that invasive panel? So there are many species of geckos that are probably introduced by humans. For example, you find house geckos, you find a type of Brooks gecko. So we don't really know whether all of these were introduced by humans, but because they are also mostly found in and around houses and not in the forest, we think that they have probably been introduced by people. And geckos can be introduced by any number of means. They can come in on their own on floating logs. They usually get transported with the material. Dilip says it's interesting to say bat snake instead of rat snake. Yeah, so probably. Suman Malik says, I would like to know whether 10 degree channel affect habitat distribution in Andaman and Nicobars. Suman, I don't think I quite understand the question, but I think what you mean to say is whether the 10 degree channel is the reason for different types of habitat present in Andamans and Nicobars. So there is some merit to that argument. There are some differences between the evergreen forests that are found in Andamans versus those found in the Nicobars. And it could be also due to the dispersal of difficulty of dispersal across this channel for many floristic elements also. But it needs further study. Subhayan Das Gupta asks, are there no terrestrial tortoises on the islands? What about turtles around the islands? So there are no terrestrial tortoises on the islands. There is a freshwater turtle found in the Nicobar Islands. It's called the Malayan box turtle. So I did not focus so much on turtles. I was mostly focusing on lizards and snakes and frogs. There are also four species of sea turtles that are found in the waters, including the largest of all the leatherback turtle that nests in both Great Nicobar Island and Little Andaman Island. Ashwati asks, are there any coral snakes in Andaman waters? Okay, so there are no coral snakes in Andamans. And as a general point, coral snakes are not generally, at least the Asian coral snakes, are not found in water. They're called coral snakes only because of the bright colors. So Andaman has sea snakes. And sea snakes you will find in other places also in India. Throughout the coast, you will find sea snakes. Raghuraman asks, is there any preventive measures there to reduce the invasive species? Right now, I don't think so. Because preventive measures would basically require you to identify, screen every, let's say, cargo that is coming into the islands or people that is coming into the islands. But right now, we don't have any such facilities to. See, accepting that invasive species are a problem itself is not fully, there is no full acceptance of that yet. Only when that acceptance comes, I think that we'll start thinking about preventive measures. Adesh Shivkar says, so I photographed a black tree snake with green lateral line. Yeah, please, you can send me the photo. I can have a look. Anusuya Pal says, the king cobra is different from kings found in India. It looks different. I believe there are people who are studying taxonomy of king cobra. So they'll probably complete that part of it. I'm not really a taxonomist myself, so not sure. Which are the marine turtles? Sarath Champati asks, which are the marine turtles found there and how are they being protected or conserved? So Andamans has, like I said, the leatherback turtle, a green sea turtle, hawksbill turtle, and also the olive redleys. All four species are found there. And there are many protected areas, especially in the marine protected areas in the Andaman Islands. So fairly good protection. The beaches are being protected in many places, especially after the tsunami. Turtle nesting had stopped due to beaches getting washed away. But in many of those places, they have started nesting again. But other than that, there are no hard protective measures in most places. I think there is one place where Forest Department does some active protection of nests during the nesting season. But again, I'm not a turtle biologist myself, so you'll have to ask turtle biologists about this. How did the Samuel George asks, how did these Indian bullfrogs got introduced to these islands? Okay, so from conversations with farmers in the Andamans, what we realized is that people brought them as food. So you know that bullfrog is eaten in many parts of the country, right? So people have brought these bullfrogs to release in their field. There are lots of rice fields in the Andamans. So they released them in the ice, in these rice fields, and they started expanding in numbers. So that is one way of introduction. There is also a possibility that they were introduced as part of fish stock, when fish were brought in from other mainland India. The tadpoles of the frog was also part of the fish stock, and they got introduced into different places. So there are at least two different ways in which the frogs have come in. Jagannathan Vishwanathan asks, no skinks in the islands. Of course, there are skinks in the islands. The crate I showed, it was eating a Andaman litter skink. And in fact, I think one of the largest skinks in India is found in the Andamans. It's called the Tithlis litter skink, almost half a meter long species. Nicobar also has tree skinks. Deba and Guyana's, how's the call of a crab-eating frog and Andaman bullfrog? Oh, how do I it's difficult to describe, right? Sorry. Dilip Kakaipura asks, is amphibians of this region different in physiological adaptation than other habitat? The answer is, I don't know. It'll be a very interesting thing to look at. I would suspect that many of the species that are capable of dispersing between islands across the sea, they should have some sort of physical adaptation, but that'll be a very interesting study. Look at amphibians in islands. So Lenovo, who's Lenovo, says that earlier it was said that there are no crows in these islands. Is it true? Are crows seen there? So yes, Professor Rauf Ali used to have a very interesting story about crows, how there were no crows in the islands, at least there are no house crows in the islands. So he once mentioned that he saw the first few crows that were being transported to the islands on a ship. They were basically sitting on a ship, and as the ship went into the port there, these crows flew into Port Blair, and now they are everywhere. So I think they were also introduced. I don't know how true the story is, but yeah. What about Apodus in the islands? What is Apodus? Sorry, I'm not sure. Shubham Soni. Given the difference in the diversity between Andaman and Nicobar, can you please comment on the biogeography of both? Maybe about when did the biogeographic barrier may have come into existence? Okay, so I think you're asking about the 10 degree channel. As far as we know, the channel has existed since the beginning of these islands, which is, the islands are about 5 to 10 million years old, if you just consider the current configuration of how they appear right now. So all evidence indicates that this biogeographic barrier has been present since that time. And that has in fact sort of given a different biogeographic history to both Andaman Islands and Nicobar Islands. For example, Andamans, if you look at the fauna in general, especially herpetofauna, it's more similar to the southern part of Myanmar, Burma, those regions. So sort of an Indo-Chinese fauna is found there. But in the Nicobars, you will see a lot of elements from what you call the Sundaic region, you know, the Indonesia, Sumatra, and those regions. So I think those differences are partly also due to this 10 degree channel acting as a major barrier. Dilip Kakavipras, are wine snakes not seen in this? No, there are no wine snakes in Andaman or Nicobars. Is the red-whiskered bulbul considered invasive in the Nicobars? Were they introduced? So from this is from my conversations with Professor Rawfully, that I realized that the red-whiskered was found in Andamans, but probably invasive in the Nicobars. They're quite common in central Nicobars now, and they were probably introduced because there are no earlier reports of these species from central Nicobars. You know, these are interesting. Bhautik Desai to everyone. Have you found any pythons in the caves? No, I have not seen pythons in the caves. I've seen pythons, reticulated python in southern Nicobars, but I have not seen them in caves, no. So Samuel George asks, which are the main predators that feed on spotted deer? Does predator population is not enough to control these introduced species? So I think the only major predator that's found in the Andamans is the saltwater crocodile, right? So we don't know how effective the saltwater crocodiles are in controlling deer numbers. It'll be an interesting thing to look at. So Anirudha Datta Roy asks, what's your take on why you don't get more than one species of tree frog on the Andamans? Given the water currents and driftwood, wouldn't you expect more tree frogs rather than terrestrial lineages? You have a 10 degree channel that is a barrier for biotic exchange between Andaman and Nicobar. At the same time, you have Felsuma that has evidently done long distance transoceanic. What makes 10 degree channel such a barrier? This would make a really interesting study. So I don't really know why some species of or some groups of animals are missing from certain islands, like why there is only one species of tree frog. I strongly believe that it has to do with basically random sampling from source regions. I really don't know why there are no more tree frogs. Mumtaz says, I am interested in fish fauna. So is there any studies and shows any diversity difference? I wish I could give you a better answer than I don't really know, because I'm really unfamiliar with studies on fishes. Anirudha Datta Roy asks, what was monitor eating in a kitchen? I don't know, maybe some geckos. Dr. Meera KM asks, please tell about the elephant you showed in the slide and what changes does it make in the canopy of forest in that island? Is it favorable to them or destroying the canopy? So there are quite a few studies on elephants in Interview Island. Interview Island is an island off the coast of North and Middle Andaman on the western side. It is a wildlife sanctuary, and there is a herd of some, I think about 30 elephants or something like that, found in that island. And if my memory is correct, I think there is significant changes in vegetation, especially damage to trees caused by elephants. So I think that would cause major changes in the forest canopy, at least in that particular island. Now, that would probably be harmful for the forest, right? I mean, the elephants are not native to these islands. So Datta Roy asks, how can you not show skink photographs? I'm really sorry, Anirudha Datta Roy. Somehow I forgot to put photos of any skinks. Shubham Soni asks, are any lacertids there? So far, there are no lacertids recorded from Andamans. So Arpita Datta asks, is the crab-eating frog we get in mainland of Sundarbans is the same species found in Andaman? So currently, they're all considered as the same species. But there are some studies that indicate that these may be different population, may be different species. But that will require further studies. Jagannath Vishwanathan asks, is there any Sicilians in the islands? So far, there are no Sicilians recorded from these islands. Anita Kindre also had the same question. So far, there are no Sicilians recorded in the islands, only frogs and toads among amphibians. Chitrapanu Parakkavur is also asking, is there a skink species there? There are many skink species in there. It's an oversight on my part to not put any skink photograph there. But there are like two species of tree skinks that are found in the Nicobar Islands. There are multiple species of small forest skinks. And also there are very large forest litter skinks, such as the Titlaves litter skink and the Andaman litter skink. Dr. Meera KM asks, any studies about Sentinel Island fauna? Dr. Meera, I think you're asking about North Sentinel Island. North Sentinel Island is completely close to outsiders. Nobody is allowed to go there, and it's also dangerous to go there as the inhabitants of the islands are, that particular island is still hostile to outsiders. I think recently there was an incident of an American pastor trying to go there and got killed by the local inhabitants. So I doubt that there are any studies on Sentinel Island fauna. So Anita Kindre asks, is Oriental garden lizard cattle are the invasive species? Then how they reach there? So cattle definitely were taken by people for, you know, raising. And many got abandoned after the tsunami, when people had to leave their houses or when the houses got destroyed. Many of these animals ran up into the forest, basically. And they got abandoned in the forest and they started becoming almost wild animals. So we know that cattle, that's what happened. For other animals, we don't really know how these animals get. But we do know that in many places, it's around the towns and cities that they are most common. So there's a strong association with the human beings. But we don't actually know many species how they get there. Okay, I think we have reached the end of questions now.
Thank you for your wonderful session. And may I invite Dr. Dilip, Associate Professor, Department of Zoology, for vote of thanks and suggestions and his views on this presentation. Dr. Dilip, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Mic, please unmute my mic. Okay.
Okay.
Can you listen to me?
Yeah.
Okay. I am very thank you for Hari Kumar for giving me this opportunity to thanks Mr. Harish Krishnan Surendran. This was a very nice, well studied, research oriented topic. He explained a very smooth manner. Andaman actually is an endemic, a very great heritage as per the biodiversity is concerned for our Indians. And the Kerala Alappi Natural History Society and Kottayam Nature Society organized a very beautiful talk by this Hari Krishnan. I congratulate the Hari Krishnan Surendran for giving and depicting all the biodiversity as per the amphibians and reptiles are concerned. He started with the cat snake and ended with the individual species and roads and tourists and threats to the biodiversity of this great natural history of our India. It's really fascinating, and he covered all the very small aspects, and for all of us it was actually the great journey, and he took all of us, all participants into the Andaman and Nicobar, just like a journey. And he introduced one by one species. He's a really a great natural curious sitter, because he studied a very downtrodden grassroots level about all the species of amphibians and reptiles. I really thankful the organization committee and Hari Krishnan, Surendran, for giving a very innovative talk, informative talk, and enlightening the minds of so many participants like us. I also learned so many things. I basically gone to the Andaman and Nicobar Island, Zoological Survey of India, the Raghupati, then Botanical Survey of India I visited. It was a really a beautiful place. I pray to the God to conserve this biodiversity and maintain. You also talk about the 2004 tsunami and its aftermath effect. It's really the natural calamity. And then also, this biodiversity is maintained. It's tribal peoples, it's the food chain, the forest ecosystem. You explain all the types of ecosystem, the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. You studied the major islands, the Ross Island you talk about. It's really fascinating. And the photography, these unique creatures that you shown, it will be remembered for all of us. And your talk will be percolated among our students, fraternity, for the society, and for most of the academicians as a treasure for explaining to students and giving the knowledge. Thank you, Hari Krishna, and thank you, Hari Kumar, for giving me this opportunity. And all the best for all your future endeavors.
Thank you, Dilip sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Hari Krishna.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving me this opportunity also. It was very nice.